Just not even bothering to mention about that.
Not turned on.
Okay.
That was just kind of small.
Okay.
Oh, my screen is huge.
Right.
And we're on.
I'm with my glasses and my
Oh, it's tonight.
It's tonight.
Oh, is that why it's not working?
That's awesome.
Thanks, George.
But you deserve it.
None of us would have noticed until all the screens went black. What's wrong with my connection?
Flip the switch.
Flip the switch.
Yeah.
Okay. It being 7 o'clock, we'll call this meeting to order. Start introducing with the board members, Kelly Kelcher, Ann Bauer, Linda Yu, Paul Kenny, Ellen Lindgren, myself, Bob Green, Superintendent Don Johnson, Diane Horning, Annette Ashley, Sean Hyland, Deputy Superintendent George Mavrolis, and Director of Business Lori Ames. First of all, thank you for coming. We're going to start out with an open hearing regarding the compensation plan proposal. We've given a fair amount of time for this because we do feel it's important that everybody's voice get heard. This is something that the board doesn't do very often, so I'm just going to start with just a couple of base rules. It's not a real large group, so I don't think it's going to be too terribly much of a concern, but just to kind of give you the kind of the rules. You know, open meeting laws allow members of the public to attend school board meetings. You guys have the right to attend and observe the meetings, but you don't have the right to speak, make motions, or vote. So what we've done is we set aside a portion of this meeting to hear your comments and concerns. So what I would like to do, if you could, is as chair, if you'd allow me to let you speak at that particular time, and then we can go from there. So please come to the microphone, address the board with your concerns. We're going to limit the time to 3 to 4 minutes. I don't know how many we have right now, Cheryl. 5, 10. So we'll keep it right around 5 minutes. If perhaps, Cheryl, you kind of keep an eye on the time, but I think it'll be pretty self-evident. You know, at a certain point, 5 minutes is a fair amount of time. After we finish with this portion of it, we will have the administration that will have the ability to do some clarification on that. Typically, the board will not do a back and forth with the audience, but we may, after comments are made, we may have an internal discussion amongst the board members about a particular point. However, there will be no decisions made during this particular portion of the item. That'll happen later on. And so just so you have kind of a feel for that, and also the ability to ask questions of the board, you really won't be able to have it. So use your time when you are asked to come up here to voice your concerns. And again, from the board, we are going to limit the, I say, the back and forth. So after somebody has spoken, you know, please check with me and ask, and we'll ask a question, either a clarification for discussion amongst the board or a clarification from administration. But again, I really hope that you don't say, well, I'm going to vote in this particular manner, because that's really not this portion. That will be even later on the agenda. We don't want it to seem like a decision is being made during this portion. We just want this to be more of an information gathering type situation. So at that particular point, let's open this up. And first person would like to speak.
Love John.
Thank you, John. If you could introduce. Oh, okay.
With Middleton-Cross Plains Area School District. I've worked in the district for 17 years. I'm located right now at West Middleton. First of all, I want to thank everybody for taking the extra time. It sends a clear message that you do want to hear what staff has to say about the new compensation model, about different things going on in our district, when you dedicate that time for us to come and address the board. I also appreciate that each and every one of our comments and statements are available to you to read through. And I trust that our staff has done a good job. I've seen the comments, and I've seen the 35-page document, and there is some good feedback in there. So I'm not going to repeat a lot of that, because I know you have that in front of you. But I just kind of wanted to talk a little bit about what it's been like since Act 10. And I'd say it's an understatement to say we have struggled since Act 10. Across the state, teachers have been faced with a profound level of unfamiliar change that has led to uncertainty, handbooks, revised compensation models, decreased morale, increased pressure to do more with less, increased class size, decrease in classroom budgets, increase in healthcare premiums, increase in contributions to pensions, increase in the number of early retirements, mid-career job shifts, and perhaps most telling to what our future holds, a significant drop across the state in college enrollment in the field of education. I know this is not news to anybody sitting in this room, and I know all of our roles have been challenged. I know we all felt frustrated at one time or another, or maybe for some, we still feel that way. And given the relative newness of these situations, that shouldn't come as a surprise. I'm here tonight just to ask a favor. I am asking for consideration from a teacher's view. Although I mentioned we have all felt the impact of Act 10, I think we can agree the greatest direct impact has been on teachers. It has been a shift most of us can honestly say we never expected to experience, and we are still adjusting. When you consider the feedback, please consider all that has transpired to this point. I know the bottom line is the budget. I know the money needs to be there in order to increase the compensation. I know the money is not there, but we are. We are still here, and we are still giving more than what we have to give, and that is the one thing that has not changed. The overwhelming concern regarding the proposed compensation model is we are doing more for less and for longer. And at this point, that's our bottom line. Again, I do appreciate you taking the time to listen to any of the feedback we have to give. I appreciate the opportunity, even though it means more night meetings, to kick it back to the committee if necessary. But I appreciate the commitment from both administration, the board, and from staff to do so to make sure all of our questions are answered, understood, and to maybe know that we can't move forward this year, but that we made a commitment to continue to move forward to do what's best on behalf of our entire district. And that's it.
Thanks, Joelle.
Thank you.
Thank you, Joelle. And again, I want to thank you for that. I didn't really hear any questions or clarifications on that, so okay. We'll move to the next person. Oh, wow. This is totally different than what I was expecting here.
Yep.
Is there anybody, even though we've heard those concerns and comments have been put, is there anybody who would like to express an individual concern, even though we've actually received a copy of that and perhaps want to add to that?
I have one. It's not mine. It's as a member of the... Sorry, I'll go up here. My name is Joanna Cree. Hi. I teach fifth grade at Glacier Creek, and I'm a member of the Compensation Committee, and put it out to our staff that I would be attending tonight, and if they had anything they wanted reiterated or heard, that I would be that representative. So this is not my personal situation, but this is something that a teacher at Glacier wanted voiced. So her... concerns. She says, I feel very undervalued as a teacher who came into this district as a 10-year veteran. I am being put basically at basically a fifth or sixth year teacher spot because I will be based on our current salaries, which were frozen for years, I know. I feel that it makes me want to look for other job opportunities outside of the district and or education to feel that the Middleton District is putting a now 15-year veteran, a good teacher, at a level E most likely. The points given to me each year for teaching for 1 year is also very disappointing, as they are in-district years used in the calculation, not years teaching. I'm assuming she's referring to the profession, the length of service points. I feel that MCPASD does not value out-of-district experience, and that hurts. So that's just one thing that a staff member wanted brought up again.
Thank you, by the way. Appreciate that. And before we move on, Don, did you want any clarification on that?
I don't know if I need to clarify. I think that was one of the pieces of feedback that we received, which was I think the initial plan was that in-district years of experience were going to be counted for that longevity categorization. And so we did receive feedback from those who came into the district with a number of years of experience that they felt that that should also count for that longevity categorization, where you got either 20, 25, or 30 points. So we did, you saw that, I think, in the feedback as well. So I think that's what she's addressing here.
Yes. I just had a question, because Joanna had stated that this particular teacher is anticipating being a level E, which sounds like it would be about 5 years experience in the transfer. I think that was more of the concern than maybe the longevity credit.
Yeah, so the 5 years issue is really more whatever their salary is they would receive, and I think we've talked about this with the board and certainly with the committee and also in schools, is that whatever your salary level would be, if you were in that gap group, you may have an adjustment, or if you were at the bottom of the schedule, you'd be brought to $39,000. Then there would be a 2% increase. then there would be a transfer to the next salary level. I actually left out the first step, which is a lane change. So the where you are in E, F, G, H, or I isn't really the number of years. It's really equated to what your current salary is. And so we would never, ever take anybody down, but they would be placed at the next natural salary step up. So in the past, I know that E meant 5, but I think in the future, E probably wouldn't mean 5. That doesn't take away the issue of sometimes there are teachers that have different levels of experience that might be at the same pay level and pay grade. So that is a factor that was expressed to us.
Okay. Any further clarifications on that? Please feel free. I know it sounds strange, but for asking, I see other people in the audience. You know, if you do, even though you felt that your concerns were addressed and what the board received in feedback, if there is a personal twist or spin that you'd like to put on that so we could at least feel that, please feel free to come up here, because the whole reason for this is we wanted to make sure that the board got as much of a feel for the concerns that were being expressed on the paper, but sometimes it's easier for us to get a feel for what's going on from hearing from an individual. Okay. All right. Excellent. Thank you, Jay.
Hey, everybody. I'm Jay Barbeau. I teach at Glacier Creek. I'm on the Compensation Committee, and so I've talked to a lot of colleagues. I didn't plan on speaking tonight, so I apologize. I said to a couple board members earlier, I have no idea why you'd want to be board members. And I appreciate the fact that you're here on a Monday night and all those Monday nights doing what you do. I think it's a thankless job. The Compensation Committee it's been a good experience of working together. At the same time, I think that I said during the meeting that what we develop is going to feel like teachers are doing more for less money, because we all have 2008 in our minds, and it's not 2008 anymore. So things have changed for you, and they've changed for us, and I think that's where a lot of the disconnect comes from. So what I hear from teachers is that there's a lot on teachers' plates, and they're being asked to do more. I hear it over and over, with nothing coming off of it. And so when I look at all the comments, and I read through all of them, I can't figure out exactly what teachers want right now, but looking at these comments, but I know that teachers feel overwhelmed, and when it became real, when this compensation package became real, the voices grew louder, at least in my room. So I guess I'm hoping that we can go back to the drawing board a little bit as a compensation group and talk about it. I'm sorry if that's inappropriate to say it, but
no.
I really do think the comments grab what teachers feel. So, but I also know it's very long, and I just want to say that I appreciate the fact that we can work together on it. But I do hear from the teachers that they're pulling their hair out right now, and I know that you've heard that and you know that. So everybody's squeezed at every level, from the top down, and we recognize that, at least I do. And so thanks for what you're doing, and I hope that we can get this done together.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jay.
Any clarification points here? I was lucky enough to be a part within Jay's group, and so I do want to say thank you for coming up and speaking. Anybody else? Going once? Going twice? Okay, at this particular point in time, I guess we're going to come back and listen for administration in terms of clarification and responses that were given to us. Don, are there any points that you wanted to talk about?
You know, I think what we try to do is address the questions with a response, so those are pretty self-evident. I think it might be just easier for board members to sort of raise issues that you think need more, you know, discussion among the board, or if there's some clarification that wasn't made. There's just a lot of information here. I would hesitate to start going point by point through this long document. So I think I'd open it up. Certainly, I had 3 board members that were part of the committee. George, Lori, Tabitha, and I are all here. So if there's some point of clarification, I think that might be the best course of action. There's just a lot there. Certainly, the reason for taking the time to maybe reconsider some of the input was that I felt that if there was a hearing, that there was a lot of input, and frankly, we got a lot in writing, that to take 5 minutes or an hour of input and then immediately vote seemed to be maybe not sending the right message in terms of listening. So we certainly considered the option of having a fairly immediate meeting with the committee, possibly maybe next week, as early as next week, to try to say, do we really want to reconsider any aspects of the plan? What would that be? And how would we justify that? I would hope that we're not starting over from zero, but maybe there are some changes that we could make that would sort of ameliorate some of the concerns. And I think we've worked through a lot of those already. So, you know, I think instead of taking any offense at some of the comments, it's really about how do we make the plan better? And is there a way that we can refine it that makes it that much more acceptable to a larger group of teachers? Because I think we know, we wish we had more resources, but we also know that we have to do this together somehow and come out of this as a board, teaching staff and administrative staff and all the other employee groups, you know, in a way that we feel we can serve our community. So really, I think we're trying to just come up with the best possible solution that people feel we care about our staff.
Okay, that's on. We'll open up to board members. I think Don had a good suggestion.
No, I mean, I think there were some individual questions that were on there that might not represent a lot of people, but I mean, the idea that are we expecting this of our administrative team? And non-gender guys, you all on the administrative team, had so much to keep up with as well. That maybe could be clarified in some communications. Certainly, your hours have been increased and your demands on your educator effectiveness and all that. That might be a point that could be made as well. And I don't know how many people feel like we're putting it all on the teachers and not on the
If it's okay with the board, I'm just kind of going to go down the line. Paul, anything that you want to contribute?
I'm very happy that it's on the table that we're going to send it back to the compensation committee, because I think that's the appropriate thing to do and let their background knowledge in this is, after all those meetings, is so much deeper than anything I could do tonight. It only makes sense to me. I did have one question, because simply I didn't understand. And it's not going to be fair to you, Don, because
it's okay.
It's in the dislikes.
We're good.
You might not understand it either. I don't know.
It's all right.
But one of the dislikes was system prioritizes hoarding credits and points. Mm-hmm. I didn't quite get that one. Do you have a better understanding of what that one means?
You know, I don't know. I didn't talk to that individual.
Sure.
I think there's certainly the way the system is set up, it allows people to build up a number of points so that if they, for example, for 2 or 3 years had more time to do professional development, to take credits, whatever that might be, that they could actually bank points. So maybe they're referring to that as hoarding. We felt that it was a benefit to actually be able to build points up so that you weren't expected every single year to get to 20, but then anything that you did beyond that was wiped out. So we kind of viewed it as kind of a total effort throughout the career versus kind of the frequent flyer miles that expire, because we feel if somebody earns the points, they shouldn't be taken away.
That makes sense. Good, thanks.
Yeah, and I also feel it's important, it's necessary to have more detailed conversation, discussion at the committee. But I just have two clarifications I want to ask down. Mm-hmm. Probably you have to answer or you may not. But when Joellen presented, she mentioned the teachers feel like they are being asked to do more with less. So I just want to get a rough idea, based on the new compensation plan, are we actually expecting teachers to do more with less? I know some of the professional development was part of the whole package in the past. We all do professional development, so are we expecting the teachers to do in addition to what they have done in the past? That was the first question.
Yeah, I think that framing that up, I think that the area that some teachers and maybe many teachers would say is that our professional development plan that's part of this compensation proposal is that, you know, the one that's specifically been proposed had 40 hours of PD per year to go to the next level. That 40 hours, if you were a first through or zero through 10th year teacher, that 40 hours hasn't previously been part of the plan. So you could view that as 40 hours of additional work that hadn't previously been there. So I think that that would be my best guess of where most people felt that they're doing more in terms of their total year. So that I think that's legitimate. It is an extra amount of time that they would put in. There are some elements of the plan that sort of offset that. The 40 hours of PD in the past might have been done in the form of credits, which would change a lane. Now that might be eliminated, given that there's one lane. So there's a little bit of a amelioration of that issue. But I think it's sometimes hard to sort of put all of that in the same description, and I'm not sure if everybody maybe put those two ideas together. So I think that's a factor. I think that generally the resources in the district in terms of curriculum materials, technology, and other sorts of things, I think have certainly been comparable, if even not increased over the last few years. So I think in terms of the teaching materials, I don't think there's been less. But I think that since Act 10 went into place, and really the budget impact of what happened at the same time, is that net income went down so substantially in that 8 to 12% range, probably 10% on average, that people feel that they took a pay cut of 10%, and we just barely kind of got back that 10 to 12%, depending on the teacher, in the last year or so. So I think that they feel in 4 years, they've sort of stayed the same in terms of actual net income. Even though gross income has gone up, WRS has been a cost, more costs in terms of insurance. So I think that overall, I think my guess would be that teachers, and I think all educators, feel that, you know, that loss 4 or 5 years ago of 8 to 12% is still being sort of made up for, if that helps a little bit.
Thank you. Another question I have is, by reading through the comments, it seems like there are some concerns about getting onto committees to serve and count that as credit. So what is the, do we have like a enough opportunities for people to participate, and do we have a process on how to selecting committee members?
I think this is one of the dilemma areas, because I don't know that there's a perfect system of saying that we have like a line for committees, because some people may have more expertise in one area than another. Generally, I think that the intent of most of our administrators would be, we'd like more distributed and collaboration oriented leadership. So I think that, I don't know a principal that wouldn't want to move around those committee assignments. In the past, when they haven't always been compensated, it's been hard to sort of recruit somebody to be on every one of the committees in some cases. Some schools had no trouble, others had a little bit more of a job there. So I think that suddenly when there's points assigned to a committee, I think there's probably a higher interest in, can I get on that committee? So I don't know that you can say, for example, at the high school level, we have a department chair in English. Whose turn is it? I'm not sure that works very well. Because we need leadership skills as an instructional leader to do that, and that's probably going to be different. On the other hand, I think that our principals are very committed to involving all teachers. I don't know if there's a perfect system, though, that would be quantifiable.
I think the concern is, are there enough opportunities to spread around?
I think there are, but I think we would have to work in terms of our professional development. George could also address that, but we would have to ramp up our internal professional development to provide enough points in that area, because I think we would need to expand that.
Can I add something? We actually had a comment made in our small group from a teacher that had participated on the committee, who made the comment that a lot of the things that people may not realize, they would get these credits from things they're already doing.
Right.
So they may have involvement in certain teams and certain activities, and that now they're not getting anything for it in a new system. They may actually get some of these credits and accrue them based on their involvement.
George was kind of our lead in this sort of this point analysis. I don't know, George, why don't you go ahead and chime in a little bit, because you did a great job of laying that out for the committee.
I think we have opportunities now that would qualify for points. I think we have to, if we go with a model like this, we have to ramp that up a lot more than what we currently have, because what we don't want from our perspective is teachers scrambling just to get points from somewhere. That was never the intent. It's not good practice. And so if we have a system where we require professional development, we have to be very thoughtful to put very high-quality, meaningful experiences in front of teachers, and we're not there yet. I mean, we're just not. We have some really good offerings in our equity areas and some of our curriculum areas and some of our literacy areas, but 550 teachers at 40 hours a year, no. And so we have some work to do in that area, to be very honest.
Yeah. I think you're right about the committee. Some committee work that hasn't been recognized in the past would actually be recognized with points.
Yeah, I mean, we do have options,
but that's true. Maybe not enough, though.
Again, we have to think of the scale of 550 people.
Right.
And, you know, you may be on a school improvement team that has 10, you know, and so we have 6 schools or 10 SIT teams, that's 60 people, but we still have 550. You see, so there's still a scalability to this that we have to be aware of.
I don't think that I have a whole lot of questions, because I was kind of there through the entire process. I wish that I would have been able to attend some of those listening sessions, but because of my family and having little kids, those were not times that I was able to attend. And I look at the list of concerns, and I think that these are all things that we did talk about in the committee, and it's not going to be so much of a surprise if we reconvene to kind of work some of these kinks out. But I am very hopeful that we can tie this process up. It's been, you know, a lot of work, and it's been a long time, but I think we've gotten some valuable things accomplished, and I'm hoping that we can finish it up.
Yeah.
Well, I think Linda touched on a lot of it. My questions were personal development, too, and that kind of came up in our group, is what things classified different groups, paras having opportunities. So you're the person, or you work with a group of people to determine what are you?
Head services team, yes.
Okay. And then kind of, do you ever get feedbacks? I know on this list, like someone referenced when they've traveled overseas, like should that count?
Yeah.
So what do you get when there's individuals that say, I went here, I went there? Do you go person by person?
We would
ever
have to.
Yeah.
In a model like this, we would have to.
Okay.
Because there would be things that people want to experience,
right,
that just aren't part of our district program.
Okay.
And so in addition to developing a more robust program, we also have to gear up to take these kinds of requests and to vet them and to check up on them and see if they're appropriate and then communicate that back, again, on a large scale. So we would have some infrastructure to kind of work through.
Okay. Thank you.
I really don't have too much to contribute. Add. I know I did a little bit of work, collaboration on this whole process, but I think a lot of the sentiment of the individuals that really have participated in it, I would lean towards them and their thoughts, feedback, comments, and much to the work that's been put into this. Hopefully we can get this wrapped up shortly and not have to start the whole process all over again.
Annette?
Well, I think from my observation, there's been some comments and feedback that came back that was kind of eye-opening for everyone. So I think the whole process of having that opportunity for input was very valuable, and I totally support having this go back for the review of the compensation committee. And even though that's for those of you that are on it, that's, you know, it's already been a long process and a lot of work, but I do see there's some incredible benefit for working together and collaborating and coming out with something that will be, you know, that will approach things from the right perspective. So I think that's the best way to proceed. So.
I wouldn't say I have anything really new. I also think that going back to the compensation committee is the right thing to do. I think it's important to have the most buy-in from the most teachers. And, you know, probably not everyone will be 100% happy, but I think we can approach a little bit better percentage with going back to the committee.
Yeah. I'll finish up.
You know, the idea, the specific foreign exchange idea, I mean, there were some comments in our group, too, that sounded like, well, of course we'd want to get funds for that, but the committee just didn't think of. And I think the idea needs to be transmitted that this is an open process and it's going to get better and people will have the ability to make suggestions. And, I mean, some of them of school because parents can't get to school, and wow, wouldn't we recognize that because it will help close the achievement gap. So that's right in keeping with our goals, and it's above and beyond what's expected for parent-teacher conferences. So I mean, I think ideas like that from our staff, there are things they're already doing, and there are things that are worthy of being recognized. So
well, I'm going to kind of do a wrap-up here. First of all, we had some really good points here brought up. One of the things that I've always been consistent about when we've been talking about not only the handbook but also the compensation was, to me, the process was just as important or maybe even more important than the outcome. And because I think, first of all, it needed to be transparent. It needed to make sure that people felt that their voices were being heard. And based on the comments that we saw, I'm not looking at this fact of going back to the compensation committee as a setback at all. It just means it was just one more step in the process to make sure that everybody's voice was heard. We may not be able to give them the answers that they were looking for, but we also wanted to make sure that everybody felt their voice was being heard, because this is just the first step in a process that's going to continue on for many years. And it's always the first steps which are the most important. And I want teachers to understand and feel like their voices are being heard, that we are listening. As much as I'd like to say that we could do the things that you want us to do, we are restricted by our financial situation and also by some of the laws and rules that are set upon us from outside of our area that we have to follow. So unfortunately, there are things that we cannot change. But certainly by the fact that you're bringing those to us here, not only to the board, but also to administration as well, all listening at the same time, all listening to the same questions, all listening to the same clarifications, makes it a little bit easier for people to think that what their concerns were actually being heard and listened to. So at this particular point in time, unless there's any other comments, clarifications from either board members or administration, I'm going to bring this part of the hearing to a close, and we're going to move on to the regular board meeting. First of all, thank you. Before we do close it up, I want to say just thank you. There are some people who've taken some time, member of the compensation committee, who are here tonight.
There were a lot of positives on this.
There were a lot of positives. There's no doubt in my mind. True. We all have a tendency to look at the negatives and not talk about the positives. But I just want to say thank you to the people who are here tonight, who've taken again out of their life and coming here to the meeting. And I want to say that not only board members, administration, but people in the audience as well. It's important. It's important to everybody. So thank you for that. Yeah, even you, Perry. So at this particular time, we're going to move on to number three, items for action. The first one we're looking at is approval of a 2% wage increase for all non-teaching staff. Don?
Basically what we had done is looked at the 2% increase for all other staff as a something that had been kind of a status quo, kind of a level for other staff, for a couple of reasons. The teaching staff increase is estimated to be about 3.1 to 3.2%. This increase really isn't dependent on the teacher compensation model. The other thing that we felt was important to kind of move forward on this, you know, one of the reasons to move forward on this was that when the compensation is determined for the teachers, if the other increases are already in place, employee services will be much more effectively able to sort of implement a more complicated increase for teachers. It is possible that if the board acts in November, that we could actually get pay processed before the first of the year, not guaranteed, but possible. So we wanted to maximize the chances there. We wouldn't be recommending any different number. We've set aside this kind of 3.1% approximately for the teacher salary range, so we felt that this would be a good time to allow employee services to move forward. Also, just to kind of reiterate, maybe for the public as well, is that the minimum amount that a teacher would receive, even in the least favorable situation, is 2%. So no teacher would be receiving less than 2% in the package, some more than 3% depending on where they fall in the salary schedule.
Okay, so looking for a motion for approval of a 2% wage increase for all non-teaching staff.
So moved.
Second.
Further questions, discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Okay, thank you. All right, possible approval of compensation plan for teachers. Thank you.
Second.
Questions, concerns, comments? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Thank you. All right.
Maybe just a point of information. We do have Bob Butler tentatively set aside for November 4th to do a compensation committee meeting. It's not we don't have to do it then, but we wanted to set aside a day that he was available. So if that is possible, we thought that that would be a good shorter term time to really engage that committee versus waiting 2 or 3 or 4 weeks. So maybe just take a look at that, especially members that were part of the committee. We didn't want to waste a lot of time because we know that we would like to have a finished product. We would like to get teachers paid, and we would like, if possible, to do it before the holidays.
What time are we thinking on that?
Well, we probably would start at about 8:30 and probably go through about 3:30 is my guess. If we're done earlier, we don't have to go till 3:30, but we just wanted to make sure we finished our work, if at all possible. So we did want to do that preliminary work to set at least a potential date. That way we could bring back information from the compensation committee to the board on November 9th. If need be, or if possible, you know.
If you want to set up a feedback type.
So maybe especially the Bob, you, Ellen, and Ann, if that's possible, that's the key. And then we would check with the compensation committee to verify that they can. They're not all here tonight, so we'll have to send something out to them tomorrow. But we didn't want to assume anything until we actually had gotten word from the board in terms of your.
Just a point on that. That's parent teacher conferences.
Yeah. So
that's going to be probably
it's the only date we could actually get Bob Butler. So we kind of felt we kind of needed to go with the person that had facilitated our process. But what's that?
November 4th.
That was the 4th of November. Sorry. I believe it's a Wednesday. Yeah.
I'm unable.
Okay.
But, you know, if you want to.
I can make it work, but I just know that that's going to be hard for an elementary teacher.
Is it probably not every school is doing parent teacher conferences that date though?
Is Glacier on that day too?
So that's a sunset. Is that the sunset?
Yeah, and there's no one on the committee from sunset anyway.
Okay. So maybe that's a better day actually. Okay, all right. We'll target that, but we'll send that out tomorrow to verify that works for everybody. Okay, thanks. We'll plan on that 4th tentatively. Thanks.
And again, thank you again for your time. Move to approval of school forest plan grant. Amy?
She actually, she thought it was going to be on consent, yeah. So she left.
Oh, did she? Okay.
We accept this.
Second.
Any questions? Yep. Awesome. It is wonderful. Yes. Any questions, concern? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All right. Approved resolution authorizing temporary borrowing amount not to exceed $3.8 million pursuant to Section 67.12 Wisconsin statutes. Lori?
Each of you should have a sheet that looks like this in front of you. We put this out to bid. Bids were due today at 10 o'clock, and Robert W. Baird was the winning bid. They had a net interest rate of 0.648, net interest cost of $21,478.44. We had four bids, of which that was the lowest. The highest was over $30,500. So there was quite a differential between low interest rate and high interest rate. So we would be looking to have the board approve the cash flow borrowing. We'd receive the money next Tuesday, and it would be due, or next Monday, I'm sorry, and it would be due September 16th of 16.
Second.
Any questions, concerns? It's not notified on this one? No. Oh. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. Okay, adopt the 2015-16 budget and certify the tax levy.
You have a packet in your, or information in your packet regarding the final information for the budget. I'm not going to go through each of all of it in detail. I'm just going to highlight a couple of areas. From a taxing standpoint, the total tax levy would be $67,578,826, which is a 3.87% increase from the prior year. We are very excited to see that the equalized property valuation actually went up 2.83% in our preliminary budget. We had estimated 1.5, so this was great in terms of how that increase is reflecting it economically what is happening to our area, which is very positive. When we look at the mill rate, we are looking at going down to 11.63, which that results in about a $24 increase if you have a $200,000 property, $36 increase for a $300,000 property, or $400,000 if you have a $48 property, making the assumption that everybody is assessed and everything is handled equally in all of the municipalities, which is not always the case in terms of where the growth is more or less. But just in looking at that overall, I was very pleased to see that dollar amount come in as low as it did. When we look at expenditures and revenues just in general, from an expenditure standpoint, still no surprise that about 81% of our budget, operational budget, is salary and benefits, and that about 76% of the revenue that funds those operational expenditures comes from taxes, because we are a district who receives very little aid and is actually on a 15% decline every year. So I guess at this point, I would entertain any questions you might have.
Nice to see the increase in the equalized value.
Yeah, that was great.
A nice increase.
I move to adopt the budget and certify the tax levy.
Second.
Any further questions or concerns? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? All right. Again, my appreciation to the board for the change in the way we did things. We're now going to actually be looking for approval of minutes.
Oh, wow.
I know.
Second.
Any questions, concerns? All those in favor say aye.
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 Okay, communications. A little bit different portion here.
That's good. It keeps us on our toes.
Yeah. It does. It does. Citizen comments will start. Is there any comments? Citizens at this point, I think they've left us. I think they've said what they've had to say. Okay, all righty. Correspondence, board communications. I know Ellen, you'd sent off. You go ahead.
So I wrote a letter after Representative Tepper and Senator Voss decided to, NASS decided to put forward another idea that they had about our bathrooms, which we've already
Oh, sure. The,
yeah. So I wrote to them, and I wrote to our representative, Diane Hesselbein, and our Senator John Erpenbach, and I had some communication back and forth with Diane and helped try to set something up with for the representative to sit down and talk to somebody who knows something about this. And I hadn't heard back from John, but I got a letter from him that I can share with you if you want to see it. It was one of those things that happened, as it seems to be happening a lot, and quickly, and so I just decided to write it on this person who has multiple interests in this area. So it seems like there's a lot of things that are happening.
Restriction for every 2 years in the school referendums. Yeah.
But we believe in local.
That was the whole idea. Sorry.
And I sent out, yeah, this, that if anybody, it's sort of short notice, but it's the ability to sit down with board members from the surrounding areas, Columbia County and Dane County, and maybe another county. Because the money that the DPI is certifying is now official, as which is why we voted tonight, and the impact on the different districts to get a perspective. I mean, we're kind of in a bubble here because we're growing, and which is evidence that we'll be able to think about raises and programs and things. But two very good people. I don't know if many of you have heard Tom McCarthy, but he gives Jeff Hurdle a run for his money from DPI in terms of being a wide scope of understanding. He's the former aide to Sandy Boak and very capable young man. And Jeff Leverage has been decades in education, and he's also quite good at a broad-based understanding of what's going on in districts. So if anybody, I know Bob said he can go.
Yeah, I've already signed up. Communications. Let's see, coming up in Stevens Point, the conference, let's see, I got, yeah, I think it's first week, I got it on my calendar here. November 7th, yeah. In Stevens Point, WSAB has legislators coming from both sides to speak, and then also a couple of classes. I'm going to speak with Cheryl and let her know that I'm interested in attending that as well. So if there's anybody else who's interested, please let Cheryl know, and then we'll get you signed up for that. I know it's a bit of a trip, but I've always found I did it last year.
Good.
Yeah, we did. Yeah, it was good.
I was just saying you can do it in a day.
Sure.
We got up early and went up there and came back the same day, so it's imminently doable. Yep. Stevens Point seems like a haul, but it actually wasn't too bad.
About 2 hours, not bad.
But again, I think three of us found it worthwhile. I know I'm going to, my calendar is open, so I'm going to do it before it gets filled by my wife. But if there's anybody else interested, please take a look at that. It's worthwhile. Any further communications? Okay, superintendent's report.
I think I have four or five items. One is we will finally have some information coming back to you at the first board meeting in November about school logo, and try to get a little bit of feedback from you on that. So big news there. We have gotten some new prototypes that we can bring to you. Not heavy duty real decisions, but it's kind of fun, so we'll bring that back to you. Also, I think Bob and others have mentioned the legislative bills that have been proposed on restrictions on referenda, which we believe are problematic because, number one, boards would no longer have the authority to set a special election, and those dates would have to be set with regular elections. In some respects, as you probably know, most districts that have set their referenda votes on the regular election date have fared better than when they do special elections, and they pay less. So I think in general, boards really haven't used that authority that often. And when they do, it's been pretty special in terms of their immediate needs. So I think it's probably a problem that, you know, a solution that doesn't really have a problem right now. So I think that it would be useful to allow boards, especially in the rural parts of the state, to have that authority. And the second part would be if a referendum fails, especially in some of the revenue cap referendums around the state where people are simply trying to survive, they wouldn't be able to rerun their referendum for 2 years, which I think is really a disadvantage as well. You know, I don't know why, and just, you know, speculating, I don't know why the legislature is so worried about allowing local boards to make those decisions. I think that they've been for local control, so I would hope that that would be something that would be extended to these sorts of bills. And so I think as a group, if the more that we can reinforce that, probably the better. You know, so much has been taken out of school boards, local school boards' hands, that I think that we ought to retain that authority. I think most boards realize that they have to be pretty conscious of putting a referendum out there because it's their neighbors that are voting. So my guess is most school boards are pretty cautious about running a lot of elections. So anyway, that's the piece that I think most of you have read in the newspaper. The next item is really we are still processing some special education staffing, still running IEPs. I think I mentioned this during the budget update. We're asking Jerry Nicholson, our Director of Student Services, to really run that down in a very discreet and itemized way so that if we have some additional needs, we'll have more background on that, and that's something that we'll bring forward to finance and certainly to the full board if we have some additional needs there. But we project that we probably will. And again, I think I reiterated at the last meeting that we had 250 new students approximately, and 60 of them were special education, which is almost 25%. And so that's much higher than our actual incidence of special education in the district, which is closer to 11 or 12%. So again, in terms of new students, it's almost double what we're receiving in terms of a regular ed student. So it's something that's certainly a financial impact to the district. Third, and I think I mentioned this in the board update last Friday, but it's such good news that I thought I would reiterate some of the information that Perry provided. So we've got $12,000 worth of grants for the Environmental Education Center and Classroom at Cromray Middle School. But clearly this isn't just for Cromray Middle School, because that center is really designed to be available K through, and really 4K through 12. And with $12,000 and more possibly to come, because we have some other outstanding grants, that we believe we can build a great sort of bank of student materials, field experience materials, so that literally every teacher in the district that's teaching science or some kind of investigation will have like ready to go in projects that they can take right out the door at Cromray. And with our budget cuts, in some cases, or at least our budget constraints, being able to take a bus from Northside to Cromray and do a field trip for $50, it's a pretty good deal. Okay. So we're really excited about that. Just wanted to thank Perry, Tom Kavinsky, and others that have really worked on those grants. And we've sort of become a grant writing machine, maybe, you know, just making sure we're out there. And that's all been Education Foundation work. And I just want to thank that group in general. It's just a great kickoff to that environmental classroom. So we'll be working on that this year. Deb Weitzel will certainly be involved in that. And certainly the Science Committee, with George, with Sherry, and with Laura Love, as they go through the science curriculum coordination of those experiences for our students. And then just the final piece, probably just a reminder, Thursday is no school, and Friday is no school. Thursday is the professional development day for all of our teachers. Friday is a non-contract day. So most of our folks are out. Administratively, we have people in, but generally our teachers are going to be out that day. There may be a few exceptions, but not very many. So that's a little bit of a fall break, which I think people appreciate.
Add one, Don?
Sure.
Under consent agenda, you'll see Nikki Martin And Nikki Martin is one of our Grow Your Own special education teachers that we approved during the handbook process. She's currently the Clark Street Community School Administrative Assistant. And so I just wanted you to know that it's bearing fruit, the program that we started. She's finishing up her special ed license, and we're actually going to employ her as a special ed teacher, hopefully, excellent, here in a few minutes.
The first scene is sprouted.
In the event that a compensation plan is put into place, are you going to give points for the professional development on Thursday?
On Thursday? Well, during a contract day, we would,
okay,
because they're already being paid for that.
Okay. Yeah.
So that was one of the questions that actually came up in,
that we
in
double
our meetings.
Dipping.
So that if it's outside of a regular contract paid time, that would earn points, but not inside. Okay. Unless you present, then you would earn points for that, because we give double points if you're presenting versus you're receiving PD. So if you presented for 3 hours, you'd get 3 points.
Okay. Just on
yeah, so that's a good, yeah, but it's a great question.
Anything else?
That's it.
Okay.
Thanks.
We're going to move on to consent. For your approval, I have 7A, 1, approval of bills payable, B, approval of staff appointments, as well as C, approval of foreign travel request, MHS China, and I'd also like to add on 8, C, review of 2016-2017 calendar, if there's no objection.
So,
but C has to be a decision.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So the calendar?
Oh, my apologies. We'll move that up.
The calendars were really designed to give you a quick look before we did a survey. So before we go out to the public and do surveys, we thought we'd let you take a look at it, come back in 2 weeks after we do some surveying so that you'd get the recommendation, okay, with data from staff, parents, and students. That was the plan on the,
okay, so
calendar. So
I
that's
think
item C.
Like a little bit running.
All right.
Okay. So then we'll just stay with the original consent. A, B, and C, looking for a motion for those approvals.
Moved. Second.
Any questions, concerns? All those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed? Okay. Items for information discussion, school improvement team reports. We'll start out with Alma. Please.
Sure. The support group.
Both, I guess.
She said the graphs look different than they had in the past.
It's a different system.
Taking that out.
We didn't get our state testing, as I kind of mentioned, last Friday,
no,
so
I
yeah.
Maybe
might be able to get some background on.
Hello, everyone. My name is Bob Schell, principal at Elm Lawn Elementary School. I'm in my third year in my principalship. It's my, I taught for 11 years in the district at Sunset Ridge, Glacier Creek, and also Cromrie Middle School most recently. I wanted to thank our school board members that we see at Elm Lawn quite often. Ms. Yu and Mr. Kinney, I see you on a daily basis. And
not today.
Not today. And Mr. Highland also came for a visit, so I wanted to thank you also for coming to tour our school. Any of you, of course, are welcome at any time to pop in and schedule an appointment with me, and we can show you around and tell you the good things that are happening there. I can go now. I wanted to start by talking about my mustache. As funny as that sounds, the hairiest month of the year is almost here. Movember is coming. And it's awareness for prostate cancer, testicular cancer, which I am a recent survivor of testicular cancer, men's mental health, and also physical inactivity. And out of solidarity, this image is from 94-95. That's our head custodian, Carl Tice, and you can see he's sporting his mustache. We have another one here.
It's Joe.
In case you missed it, it's right there. I just like to use my laser pointer.
1992.
Yeah, this one is from 91-92. That's correct. We've got another one here. Lauren Carley, I coached in high school track at the state track meet. So there's Lauren.
About 30 years old now.
She is. Yeah, I think she's out of college. Yeah. And here's one more. This one is from 98-99. You'll see a few familiar faces right here. There's Tom, Tim Keeler, George. Amongst the other administrators there sporting mustaches. So I just wanted to start with that and show a little solidarity and a little Elm Lawn history coming your way. I have the scrapbooks on my desk right now, and we keep them in the library if you'd ever like to page through. I know that you've seen our achievement data from last year that was in the board packet, and I just wanted to point out that our achievement goal, we did hit our goal. Our target for the percentage of students above the 50th percentile, our goal was 75%, and we came in right at 75%. And that's on our grades 2, 3, and 4 MAP assessment for reading. And the percentage of students who met or exceeded their projected growth goal, our target was 65%. I believe at the winter assessment window, we were right around 64%, so we thought we were right on track. And then we saw the typical drop that we see across all of our schools from winter to spring, and it's a bit of a head-scratcher, but that is something we're taking a look at. And we ended the year at 59% of our students hit their projected growth target, so we have not hit that goal yet. And we also set a gap goal, so there's a target for our below benchmark students, so students that started below the benchmark in the fall, and we took a look at the students above the benchmark in the fall, and the students above benchmark from fall to spring on their reading MAP assessment, they grew 8 points, so that's our above benchmark students, and we wanted our below benchmark students to grow even more than 8 points, so we set a target of 6 points more than their above benchmark peers. And our below benchmark students grew 15 points. So they hit that 6-point goal. So that was great to see as well. In terms of what our school improvement team is planning for this year, we took a look at our Fountas and Pinnell is what we're changing to. You're going to hear that a lot, or FNP. Fountas and Pinnell is the reading assessment that we're using. And students get a letter grade, A through Z on that, or double A through Z. And last year in the fall, so this is school-wide on the Fountas and Pinnell, we were at about 68% of our students were above benchmark starting out in the fall. And this year, we're at 72% of our students are above benchmark starting out in the fall. So that's 68% to 72%. And then in our MAP assessment, we're still using the MAP assessment for math. In the fall, we were at 79% and now we're at 85% in the fall above benchmark starting out. So We have some high targets to shoot for this year when we're looking at our goals. We will also have an achievement gap goal. My SLO, or school learning outcome, was very similar to our school learner outcome that we had as a school goal. Instead, I was looking at individual students. So my goal was 60% of students below benchmark will gain that 6 points on their peers. So not so much an average, because individual students can kind of get lost in averages. We wanted to see a certain number of our students make that or close that gap. So that may be very similar to what we'll do this year with our Fountas and Pinnell, or FNP, goal. Any questions on, you know, last year's progress or anything like that before I move on to this year? I think there'll be some time at the end too for questions. Okay. So some of the things to highlight, last year we recognized 375 students a total of 653 times for their positive behaviors. So that means I called students down to my office 653 times last year for positive behaviors that staff referred them for. This year we're on that same pace. Our positive behaviors so far this year, 147 students or 147 events, some have been repeat students, have been called down to my office in the morning for something that they did well. That's our PBIS program, in which we're rewarding positive behaviors and recognizing positive behaviors. So far this year, our office discipline referrals were at 38. We had 27 in September and 11 in October. So we are at about a 4-to-1 ratio of positives to negatives. And I would just let you know also that, you know, about 2/3 of those are repeat students that are having some struggles in the classroom, and we're giving them additional supports and taking them through our tiered behavior response. In terms of equity efforts, our extended school day, we're really hoping to continue that. Transportation may be a little more difficult this year because the middle school and high school end times to their day have been cut 15 minutes earlier. So Ann Soley is a fourth grade teacher at Elm Lawn, and she and I are meeting with Jeff Fedler to see what's possible for any after school extended school day options. We can put our elementary school students on the bus to ride on their routes with middle school students, and we're trying to see if that's the route we'll go or if we might try to work something else out. We also have the option of, you know, a summer school program, or how we would like to use those funds to boost our achievement for our struggling learners. We also had a MyFi and Chromebook summer program, so some of our students were selected based on achievement and need to sign out of our library some Chromebooks and some MyFis if they didn't have wireless internet at home. And our achievement gap action team, which I will talk a little bit about, is monitoring the progress of those students, and we did see some positive gains. So that may be something we'll continue to do and send Chromebooks home as soon as possible with similar students or those same students to give them access to that. Also, Mrs. Holt, Amy Holt, developed a program called Cardinal Buddies, which was brought about by parent input. We had a parent of a student say, you know, my student is one of few African-American students at your school. What are you doing to meet his needs? And we said, what are we doing to meet his needs? And so we partnered with the Student Voice Union, Antonio Hoy at the high school, and the Student Voice Union has been coming to Elm Lawn about once or twice a month, depending on the high school schedule, and they're mentoring our African-American students now. We hope to grow that program to include our Latino students, our Asian students, even our white students down the road. So that's something we want to continue. And we also had 4 staff attend the Equity Institute this summer. And I'm kind of a Google guy, and we have a spreadsheet of all of our staff meetings and all of our meeting times together. And student engagement and equity is one of our columns, and we want to make sure that we're touching on equity and having those important conversations at all of the times that we get together as a staff. How am I doing on time? I've got one more.
Doing fine.
Okay. One last thing I wanted to share, which is kind of a goal of mine, more distributed leadership. Several of our district and building leaders attended a session this summer that talked about improvement strategies and having six or less big rocks out there. So we recognize that staff are feeling like we pile on more and more initiatives and that kind of stuff. So we said, you know, what are six things we could focus on? And maybe even at the building level, we'll really focus on one or two of those six. So there's six, we call them red boxes. They're the right to learn, assessment drives instruction, instructional practices, student engagement, meaningful collaboration. And then the sixth box was left unfilled, but we chose wellness at our building. So I think that might be district-wide. And so our school improvement team decided that it would be great for our four action teams. One of our staff meetings a month is an action team, which staff do some work on achievement gap, curriculum and instruction, wellness, or behavior. So each team did the same activity where they chose one or two of the six red boxes, and then they decided on some leadership strategies or some things they were going to do in these blue boxes. And what we found was all of the six areas were covered by our action teams, and then our school improvement team decided to really focus on meaningful collaboration because that one wasn't covered by our action teams. So that's an example of distributed leadership, our staff really having some input and a say in what we're doing to meet our students' needs in those areas. So that's what I had to share for today, and I open it up for any questions or comments.
Actually, I wanted to speak to your program with African American by using the student voice, students coming over. In some of the research I've been doing on some more successful programs school districts have sponsored to take care of equity issues, one was the use of students who are succeeding and doing well, who look like they're, who have the same physical appearance, the kids who are not doing well. There seemed to be more of a credibility in this talk about the bringing people down from the high school at these schools and bringing them down into elementary and middle school levels to basically act as tutors, mentors type things, saying, yes, these are the strategies that work for me and these would work for you. So I'd be very interested in hearing how that's working out.
I can tell you that our students have been asking on a regular basis when they're coming. They're very excited to see those students and to connect with them.
Because it doesn't necessarily have to cost a lot of money to be effective, as long as it means something to the individuals and it's effective for them. And I just thought that, you know, after you heard this, it was very similar to what I'd been reading about the programs that were very effective. So I'd certainly like to hear more as it moves forward. Further questions? Thank you.
Oh, I like that phrase, distributed leadership.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That?
I like that phrase, distributed leadership.
I just have one comment because my younger daughter goes to M. Long, and every day when I drop her off and I can see all the faculty and teachers, they are very happy. And the coaches, I think the PE teachers, always standing in the front of door and, you know, high five with everybody. And it's really very exciting and inviting. And, you know, thank you for doing such a great job.
And I'll second that.
That's a tough act.
Oh,
yeah.
Go ahead. Yeah.
Mustache.
Should have gone first. Yeah.
Should have gone first. Well, that's probably good.
And before you go any further, say, Bob, I just want to say I'm a two-time survivor of prostate cancer, so you're in my thoughts as well.
All right. And my name is Chris Delk, and I am the principal at Sock Trail Elementary. This is my seventh year there as principal. Have been in the district as a teacher, had been prior to that since 1991, had taught at West Middleton, at Park, and at Sock Trail, so kind of around through different schools. And I know you have the information that was in the board packet. I'm going to talk briefly about last year and more about this year because part of what I have to report on is the new AGR, which is Achievement Gap Reduction, which used to be called SAGE. So we're actually an hour earlier than I thought we would be presenting, so that's a good thing, but I don't want to burn up that time with lots of other things. As far as last year's MAP scores and goals, we had met our goal for MAP math, a percentage over with that 75% at 50th percentile or above with the achievement goal. We did not meet that goal with the reading. Lots of things that we're looking at that have worked into our goals for this year, and specifically kind of digging into that achievement gap data a little more, on what was bringing us down in that those reading percentages. I'll start with explaining achievement gap, the SAGE and achievement gap, and then I'll go into to what we're working on this year since all of those are tied together. Is there anyone who's not familiar with SAGE, the Student Achievement Guarantee Education? That was the federal or the state program that, and it's grant money that we have received for the last 5 years. So the legislation changed with that this past year, and they rolled anyone who was a part of that contract, rolled them over for a year, and we could either go under the old rules of SAGE, which were all based on teacher-student ratio, or we could do the new program, which will be the only choice from here on out, which is the AGR, which is the achievement gap reduction. And with that, it was a lengthier application that had you looking at grades kindergarten through third grade, creating an achievement gap for both math and reading. You could choose what assessment you were using, but had to look at what strategies you were using to close that gap between free and reduced and non-free and reduced. The difficult part of doing that was the application was due before we had any baseline data. And some of the assessments that we were doing were brand new assessments. So it was kind of creating a goal and creating kind of a baseline when you didn't really have one. So it looked at last year, which might have been some different assessments, but did see, kind of looked at the trend of what that gap typically was. And those were included, the baseline data were included on the individual our goal sheets that I submitted for this year. So if we're looking at the literacy one, we will be using the PALS assessment, which is one of the state assessments that we need to do, that looks at those early literacy skills for that. And that window just closed, the assessment window just closed last Friday. So I didn't have our most current data, achievement gap data for that. The first through fourth grade in literacy will be using that benchmark assessment system that Bob had referred to, the Fountas and Pinnell system, and looking at the kids there. One thing that we found last year, you see that the gap kind of, it increases as the kids get older. And that's kind of twofold. So having that rigor that increases through the year, we're finding that it's hard for our students who are in poverty to continue to grow at that same rate as their peers who are not in poverty, as well as the gap that they begin with coming into school. So as that rigor increases, some of the kids that might have been proficient in first or second grade, where you're needing to build, bring in more background knowledge, more academic language. So not only with our students in poverty, but we're also looking at that, the English language learner piece to that as well. So there's kind of two pieces with that. With the MAP gap, we are looking at, for kindergarten, using the assessment that is already part of the New Bridges math curriculum, and that's called the CGA. And again, that assessment period was just ending last Friday, so we did not have that data. We submitted this on Thursday. And then for first grade and second grade, using something called structuring, which is looking at kids, kind of their automaticity with building numbers of fives and tens. And are they able to, if they're have eight blocks and five of them are blue and three of them are yellow, and they take away the yellow, for the kids to be able to say that there, you know, how many were taken away. Or you know, it's a quick, pretty quick thinking assessment, but it's gauging their number sense and putting numbers together and taking them apart. So that assessment is given in first and second grade, and in third and fourth grade, we're using the MAP assessments. We do not need to report on fourth grade because fourth grade is not covered as part of that grant. It's just looking at kindergarten through third. But we'll be just reporting on all grades when I report to the board. So as part of that legislation, you get to hear me twice. You get to hear me once in the fall and then again in the spring when we look at how those numbers have changed, and hopefully that gap has lessened. Another piece of that legislation that changed, and really the biggest piece, is we can choose different strategies that we use to program students with that gap reduction. And by strategies, I mean we can use class size reduction, which was the only thing that SAGE used. But we can also use instructional coaching time and one-on-one tutoring, which in our case, since we are a school-wide Title I school, our Title I teachers can count as that one-on-one tutoring. Where in the past, I would be panicking if we would be at 17 or 18 kids in a classroom across the board, because knowing if we had a student move in, that would require another teacher because we couldn't go above that 1-18 ratio. With the new model, it takes away that panic, and I can just say we're using another strategy. With right now, our third grades will be above 18. There'll be two of them will be at 19. And as far as the reporting to the state goes, it's really easy to change the strategy, and there isn't a class that our Title I teachers aren't working one-on-one with specific students on a math or a reading intervention, as well as our instructional coach is also full-time in our building. We supplemented the district position with some title funds to make that position full-time, so we could use any one of those other strategies to try to meet the needs of these students aside from the small class size. Are there any questions about that?
I had a question. So for the state purposes, the only area of gap that you have to report on is free and reduced?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we went around and around with how to write this goal. And some of our first drafts of it didn't make, how would you explain it, George? You could have met the goal by not working really hard to increase the academic level of your non-free and reduced student.
Right.
And we didn't like how that felt, because we're trying to move everybody, whether they're free and reduced status or not free and reduced status. So we worked to try to write the goal in a way that targeted our free and reduced by increasing their proficiency by 10 percentage points each year. And again, that is not only raising, and that's bringing about three kids from that beginning or developing up to proficient, but also maintaining the kids that are at proficient. So you know, 10% doesn't feel like a big number, but when you're looking at the kids, we wanted to make it a goal that we felt was meaningful, that we could look at our students and say, yes, we can do that. We can maintain and we can move. And it's in across grades and both and reading. I called DPI today just to say, do you have an update for me? Because I'm giving an update to the board on AGR. because they have not, I submitted the application at the beginning of the school year and I've not heard back on whether or not we are renewed for the next 5-year cycle. And he said that there is a trailer in the Senate and Assembly right now on the bill dealing with some language issues with it. But he did not see any reason why we would not get the additional 5 years. Wasn't quite sure if it was going to be 4 years in addition to this rollover year or 5 additional years. So,
Chris, why don't you tell them what our funding level is so that they know what we get?
We get, it's just over $2,000 per student identified as free and reduced within those grade spans. Kindergarten through third. So the amount of money we get covers about 3 additional teachers in our building. So it allows us at different grade levels to reduce that class size, which is critical to our population. Yes. So it's been a great, great resource.
I have a question for the content area, math content area, and you're using different assessment tools. Mm-hmm. You're using the structuring for first and second and then MAP for third and fourth. Mm-hmm. Is there a reason why different assessment tools are being used?
Yeah, I can tell you why we, so second grade is the first year that they take MAP math.
Okay, second grade.
The second grade is the first year that they take that. We find that a computerized test for second graders with a high population of students who don't have that kind of access to one use the computers, especially for educational purposes, that they already start at kind of a disadvantage. They're still taking that as part of the district assessment. But we're looking at what we feel like we can teach into better, and those are those early numeracy skills. So in kindergarten and first and second grade, we're really concentrating on all of those early numeracy skills that they will build on in later years. Mm-hmm. Any other questions about AGR?
Yeah, if I just wanted to jump in a little bit, You have the largest free and reduced population for our elementary schools, and you obviously you get more funding for that. And reading obviously is a concern as you get into the fourth grade. We start moving away from teaching and assuming it's a basic skill. But, you know, obviously there are more to than just the hours you spend with a child because there's socioeconomic situations which prevent a child from getting to those skills. What are some other things that you need? Because obviously there's still a lot of work to be done here to help our students become more proficient at reading, because that to me is such a basic skill.
Yeah, and if you look between the MAP reading, last year we were about 56% that showed proficiency, and the Fountas and Pinnell, we were higher than that. Part of that is the format of that assessment. I don't feel like the MAP test necessarily reflects some of the skills of our students, especially our students who have a first language other than English. Just some of our students where that computer, that technology piece is not their typical mode of learning. So I think there's a combination. One is the testing format. I think there's also other pieces that you alluded to that are part of what we try to work with when we have our summer school, providing some experiences and background knowledge. We find that the experiences and the background knowledge is huge when it comes to being able to read a story, understand a story, and bring pieces together. So as many opportunities as we can to build that background knowledge. And actually, one of the strategies that we're using that's part of our equity work this year is trying to touch on that. Another piece is Bob had talked about the transportation issue with our after-school club and how that is being used. One of the things that we have just looked at during our assessment meetings was typically that intervention time goes to by our reading interventionist, our reading teacher, or our Title I interventionist, a lot of times will go to the neediest students, but we have all of those other kids that we need to just bump into the proficient or keep at the proficient, and we're looking at, can we use that after school time as targeting that population of kids? So our can we have different focuses for different programs to meet different needs? I don't know if that answers your question.
It's just tough because between fourth and seventh grade, we have a tendency to lose some of our children, young black males and, you know, in particular. And, you know, obviously it starts kind of where you guys are finishing up. And, you know, obviously I'll be talking with George Moore and just trying to find new strategies for us to, because our graduation rate, you know, we're looking at the high school, but obviously if we want to look for solutions, we can't be looking at the high school. We have to look before. So that's what I'm
asking. We're hopeful, in fact, more than hopeful, confident that Reader's Workshop is going to look different for kids. You know, in the past where we've lost kids is because their interest waned. And part of Reader's Workshop is to maintain the interest level of kids and their choices. And I think it's going to take a few years because really we're in like year two, basically. I think that is going to hook kids for longer, and we have Reader's Workshop all the way up through eighth grade into the high school.
Yeah, I just didn't mean to pick on you, but.
No, that's fine. We also, as a district, have just added another type of reading intervention. There haven't been a lot of different interventions out there that were different than more of what we were doing as guided reading. So hopeful too that if there was an intervention that wasn't working, now we have another option to try, just to try to hit some different ways of learning for kids.
Mm-hmm. You know, I have a general question. I think, pardon me for my ignorance, and why we only have one school as a SAGE school?
We were the only school that had the poverty rate to be able to apply.
Oh, so you have to meet certain threshold.
Yes, it's based on.
About 50%, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It was, and now that's changed as well.
Oh, okay. Previous.
Okay, thanks.
Yep.
I was thinking, you know, $2,000 more per student.
Right.
We can't
do
a lot of
that.
How come then L1 can't get that?
Sorry. Thanks. Yeah, certainly. So as part of this year's initiatives, and I'll be really quick with that because we're probably taking over our 10 minutes. One of the things that we started the year out with, really trying to think about where staff left off last year with feeling really overwhelmed with new initiatives. So as we looked at, look at behaviors and looked at starting that school year, trying to refocus in a way of not thinking of new initiatives, but thinking of what kind of culture we wanted for our students and how we were going to get there and how we were going to take tools we already knew about to get there. So rather than talking about PBIS as PBIS and restorative practices as restorative practices, we talked about building a culture of character and really focused on that. And talked about those other pieces that we do as part of our daily routine of school as tools to build that. And it was really a great start to the year because it wasn't hearing acronyms where you're trying to say, okay, what's that? What's that mean? What does that stand for? It was really coming together as a staff and saying, what do we need to help our kids build the character that we want them to have to be these productive learners? And kind of what everything really boils down to is starting with relationships and going back to building those relationships with families and with kids. And that was kind of first and foremost. The other piece was looking at clear expectations across the board, which is
where there could be something that would encourage kids to take music, to take lessons, to follow through and go to primary, and, well, it's only fourth grade, so it's just strange.
Yeah, and Chris Corey, who was our past strings instructor, and Jillian, who is our new instructor, they have both been fabulous of not making that a barrier. They have found instruments for everyone. And I don't feel like that's been a barrier. We've had great participation with our students in poverty and orchestra.
Our best advertising has been Jillian Gigliarano, is her name. Our orchestra lessons in the morning before school are packed. Mm-hmm. I mean, the room is full. And the kids are really excited. So we've got our highest numbers in participation.
She had the family night
work.
Wasn't that your
school? Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, the picture. Yeah.
Yeah, that was the...
On the website.
Was that the... I think that was across the district.
Yeah, the
at the high school.
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, she's been fabulous.
And I wonder if there's not some way, given the you had the conversation with the band instructor, if there's some way that, you know, high school students could come in and help, or, you know, that kind of a thing.
Community service.
Yeah. You know, just in terms of making that collaboration between kids in elementary school and people who are in high school.
They, you know, they format the programs to be where our students get to see, you know, older students, and I'm guessing, you know, they do that intentionally, mm-hmm. so that they can see students like them, yeah. continuing in orchestra. You know, you get that natural drop as you get into higher levels, but I would say as I continue to go back to orchestra concerts, I see a lot of our kids still involved at that middle school level. Drops off a little bit at high school, but a lot of things are, you know, just because you have to make a lot more choices.
Right.
with glad to hear that. That's good. It's also something that we don't.
Right.
Other questions, comments, concerns? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Sorry for
you.
No,
great job.
Obviously, there's a lot of interest in your report, so thank you.
I got to come up with a club now. Oh, that. Yeah, 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 keep going.
You know that will come back to you later.
You're on?
I thought during the retirement, not during the board meeting. All right.
Hey, Mandy.
Hey, Mandy.
How's everybody doing?
Yeah,
you've been sitting for a long time.
Yeah.
Yeah. So if you need to stand up or stretch or move when I'm talking, that's totally fine. I won't be offended. It's all good. I need to do that too. So my name is Mandy Sirsch. I'm the Director of Bilingual Services for the district. And this is my second year in this role full-time. I was in this role half-time for 3 years while I was in AP at the high school, and this is my 15th year in the district, so I've been around a while. I'm really, really excited to share information with you about our English learners and some of the things that are happening in our department. I believe you all have some information in your board packet, so I'm going to just provide some details for you that are not included in the slides, and certainly if you have any questions or comments throughout, please feel free to just ask. The first slide that is in there shows our total number of ELLs, and ELLs stands for English Language Learners. We have a lot of acronyms in our world, right? Well, in the field of education in general, but especially with language learning. The ELLs typically refer to the students, English Language Learners. ESL is English as a Second Language, that typically refers to the program, or a license that a teacher might have. So when you see or hear ELLs, it's typically talking about the students, although people use the terms interchangeably, and that's okay. We generally know what people are talking about. So you can see that our numbers have been relatively flat and have even decreased slightly since 2011. We did do some data cleanup in 2011. We had some students who were over-identified as English language learners, so
the slight drop that we see in 11-12 and then going into 12-13 may actually be an artificial drop. It just kind of means we were cleaning up some of our data. So right now, the graph is showing we're at about 338 students, and we have had several students enroll since then, so we're probably a little bit closer to 350 now. As far as levels of our students, our students take an annual proficiency test in their English language skills called the Access Test. And that assessment is given in December and January. So we're getting ready for our testing window coming up. And it's kind of an exciting year for us because we're moving from the paper and pencil version of the test to the computer-based version of the test. So that's going to bring, I think, a number of advantages in terms of administration. And you know, we'll see how that ends up impacting our scores. But students are assessed annually on their language. And so right now, just over a quarter of our students are beginning level students. Students who are in the beginning stages of learning English. Slightly over half of our students are at the intermediate level. So that's where the bulk of our English language learners are. And then about 14% of our learners are at the advanced level. So we run the spectrum. We have seen more beginner students this year than we have in recent years. And really, you know, that population's enrollment has a lot to do with what's happening politically in the country, in the world. Just watching right now what's happening in Syria, and depending on, you know, how our country responds to refugees, we could see that population increase. We just never know. It's very dependent on that. So this year we do have more beginning level students than we've seen in a while. And so I think that's why, even though our numbers are slightly down from last year, our teachers are feeling like they're not, because they have a lot more students with more significant language needs. Our next slide is regarding the languages that are spoken. We actually have about 40 languages that are spoken by families in our district. As you can see from the pie chart, about 64% of those students that we have in our program are Spanish speakers. It's by far our largest language group. After that, our largest group is our Mandarin Chinese speaking population, followed by Arabic, Korean, and Russian. That green slice of pie that you see is really a conglomeration of many languages. It's just our other slice of pie. And the gray slice that you see is also a number of different languages, which are our different Indian languages that we have spoken within the district. So it's kind of what our language population looks like overall. One thing to note is that from a district level, when we support families who are bilingual, particularly bilingual in Spanish, we're not only supporting the parents of the students who are in the English learner program, but we're also supporting parents of students who might be fully English proficient in terms of the students, but the parents aren't yet. So we're also providing services, particularly to our Latino parents who may have English proficient children, but the parents might need some extra support. And right now, about 11% of our district population is Latino. Moving on to our next slide that breaks down some of our English learner data as it relates to students living in poverty or those who are on free and reduced lunch. About 67% of all of our English learners are students who are on free or reduced lunch. And this really plays heavily into our decision making when we're trying to allocate staffing for our ESL and bilingual programs throughout the district. We look at, of course, total numbers of ELLs, we look at the proficiency levels of the students, and we also look at how many of the students are living in poverty.
Looking at this slide, are there no ELLers at Park?
There are. We don't include them on this slide because the numbers are so small that to include the poverty information, we didn't want to make the students identifiable.
Okay.
But we do have a small population at Park as well as at Clark Street.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a great question. Thank you. So we do look at the poverty information when we're also trying to determine staffing allocations. So you can see that varies. The blue and orange students are the students who are on free or reduced lunch, and the gray students are not. So you can kind of see how that breaks down from building to building. The next slide then goes through our current staffing. Like I said, we use the information about proficiency levels and poverty to kind of determine how that all gets allocated. For many years at the elementary level, Sauk Trail was our magnet school for the English learners. And several years ago, our population grew significantly enough that we were able to provide services in all of our buildings. So we do provide ESL and bilingual support in all of the buildings across the district. That includes 9 ESL bilingual resource teachers and 3 ESL resource teachers. So we really have 12 full-time teachers who are supporting the students across the buildings. The difference between ESL and bilingual in terms of licensure, really a bilingually certified teacher is kind of like, I describe it as ESL plus. So that's a teacher who has an ESL background and they're also proficient in a second language. Bilingual teachers have to pass proficiency examinations in order to get that certificate. And because of our high numbers of Spanish speakers, we are required by state statute to provide bilingual support. So that's why we have that across our buildings. But by also being ESL certified, they can support any students who are learning English as a second language. So we have those 12 teachers. We have about 4.5 bilingual paraeducators that actually is spread among 7 people. So we have several part-time people who are supporting our students, and those are people who are bilingual in Spanish. And we have a 0.6 ESL paraeducator. So she's supporting the English as a second language students, but not proficient in another language. From a district standpoint, we do have a full-time district translator interpreter who supports, like I said, not only parents who speak Spanish, who have kids who are English learners, but also those who do not, as well as a half-time bilingual family outreach coordinator who really works hard to coordinate services and connections between parents and families and the school, as well as outside community resources. We have a half-time program assistant, as well as the full-time director, which is me. And the district support is really vital for our program, because the more we can handle at the district level with respect to helping families and connections and providing district-level support, the more the building folks can focus on instruction and really supporting the students. So that's been a really wonderful thing to have here. Our following slide has some information about our ESL and bilingual service delivery. As you could tell from our pie chart, we do have a number of languages that are spoken in the district, and ESL will therefore always be a part of what we offer here in this district. So English as a second language programming really serves to support students in many different ways as they are developing their proficiency in English. Sometimes that looks like push-in support into a classroom. Sometimes that looks like co-teaching. Sometimes that's pulling small groups of students to work on a specific skill. It really depends on the needs of the students and what's happening in the classroom. We offer transitional bilingual support for our Spanish-speaking students. That's why we have our bilingually certified teachers as well as our paraeducators. And a transitional bilingual program, it was really meant to provide native language support to the students, in this case the Spanish speakers, who need it as they become more proficient in English. The goal of a transitional bilingual program is not necessarily to help students maintain their first language. It's about using that language to support the students in learning English. So that's what we currently have at this time, is a combination of ESL as well as transitional bilingual support at all levels. But as a little teaser, coming soon to you in February 2016, we have a group of staff members who are actually working on evaluating our programs and services to make a recommendation to you as to what we think, based on our data, based on research, based on what we know to be best practice, the types of services that we should be offering in this district. So that leads us into the next slide, which is about our ESL and Bilingual Program Design Committee. And I would invite Chris or George to chime in on any of this.
Keep going.
So this is a really special committee. Last year, with some Title III funds, actually Chris and I, as well as three of our bilingual and ESL teachers, one from elementary, one from middle school, and one from the high school, were all trained in how to go through this process. So what the five of us are doing is facilitating a larger committee now in the district through this process of really digging deeply into our data on our English learners to figure out patterns and trends, particularly taking a look at our students who are exited English language learners. That means those are students who were once not proficient in English but now are. So we want to see are there any patterns to that or things we can learn from the students who have successfully exited. We're looking at ELLs who have graduated and what does an ELL graduate look like, if there can be some general statements made about that and what has helped them be successful so we can learn from that. We're also looking at our ELLs who are considered long-term. We know from research that it can take anywhere between 5 and 10 years for a student to become academically proficient in English. So we defined a long-term ELL as a student who's been in our program for 5 years or more to try to see, you know, what might be going on with that group of students, as well as our English language learners who have dropped out. And what were some of, were there any telltale factors that we might have noticed or seen coming? So it's been a really interesting process. Our group meets monthly. We met once in May, and we met in September, and we met last week for our October meeting. And we will be meeting monthly until we're ready with our proposal to all of you in February. We are also, in addition to looking at our data, reading some of the current research. The committee that we have is pretty representative of our staff in the district. We have people from all levels who wear many different hats, teachers, student services, administrators. We have invited parents to our committee meetings, but it's been challenging to find parents who can come every time. So in order to get that parent voice, we have a couple of different things going on. One is we're getting feedback from parents through our bilingual family engagement sessions, which I'll talk about in a little bit. And we're also likely going to have a focus group of parents meeting in January to come together one time to really talk about what we're working on and get some feedback, because we really believe that's vital to have that support and that voice as part of the process. We do have a couple of former students on our committee, students who were formerly ELLs who have graduated and moved on, and one is in college, and one of them is actually working for us now. So that's really exciting to have their voices, because they've been there and they've been through it. So looking at data, looking at research, and then the outcome will come to you. So we're very excited about that process. Okay, so in terms of what's next, so like I mentioned, coming to you in February, we'll be delivering some more information. We are engaged in some two-way dialogue with bilingual families. Back in September, we were excited to have Lorena Mancilla, who is from WIDA. WIDA is the research body that is out of UW-Madison, but they support, I believe it's now 33 states, it might even be more. They are the developers of the access test. They are the developers of our standards. They have written now Spanish language standards in addition to English language standards, and we're really lucky to have them in our backyard. So we had Lorena come and meet with our parents and do a parent engagement session with them to get feedback from them. So it wasn't just us talking at them, it was also us receiving feedback from them. In terms of what do you want, you know, for your children? What do you need in order to make that happen? She also provided some very parent-friendly information about the access assessment, and we had several parents tell us afterwards that is the first time anyone has ever explained it to me in a way that I understand. So it was great. We are hosting another bilingual family engagement night. It's going to be a repeat session of September, because unfortunately our first one clashed with Cromrie's back to school night, and we wanted to give the Cromrie parents a chance to come. as well as any other parents who couldn't make it the first time. So that's going to be Monday at Cromrie from 5:30 to 7:30, and any or all of you are welcome to drop by. We have no idea what kind of a turnout we get, but we hope it will be as many as we had last time or more. We had 22 parents last time, and it was amazing to have their feedback. Finally, Sherry and I were able to, as part of the Hispanic Heritage Month program, to go on the La Movida radio station, which is the local Spanish radio station, to talk about the district. We thought we were going to be on the radio for 10 minutes, and we were the entire program.
For an hour.
And at first, we were really nervous to speak Spanish, so we were speaking English and it was being interpreted. And then halfway through, the DJs or the people we were talking to said, you know, you can understand our questions in Spanish. You can speak Spanish. And we were like, ah. But we did for the second half of the program, when we even had a caller, which was really exciting. was a parent and had really lovely things to say about the district. And so it was really great to be able to share not only what's happening in our ESL and bilingual programs, but really even just to explain things like district boundaries, which are things that we're just kind of used to talking about. But we were asked a lot of questions about, you know, well, why is it that we have this school in the Middleton-Cross Plains Area School District with a Verona address, but it's part of Middleton, but kids from Madison go there, and it's really confusing to parents, especially if you're not from this country, to understand the difference between a municipality and a school district. It's very different. So, you know, even things like that were just really exciting to be able to talk about. So we've been invited to host a one-hour radio program monthly. Give me the mic. I need my headphones. So. So we're in discussions with that with other district leaders about that to see if that's something we can do, because we do have a large segment of our parent population that does access information via that radio station. Madison does have a monthly radio program that they run and have gotten good results from that. We this fall, when we had some difficulty recruiting a bilingual parent educator, we put an ad on La Movida and suddenly had a pool of candidates. So we know people are listening. And so that's something we really hope to be able to continue on a more regular basis. And finally, a project that I'm particularly excited about, that again, I'll share more about at a coming meeting, is the possibility of someday, hopefully soon, having a Middleton Cross Plains Area School District Seal of Biliteracy that we could award students who have achieved a certain level of proficiency in multiple languages, and that could be awarded to a student who is an English learner or not, you know, a student who has maybe, who is maybe an English speaker but has learned a second language to a certain level of proficiency, just really to value bilingualism and what that does to our communities and the positive impact that has. So I've been serving on the Wisconsin State Seal of Biliteracy Committee for the past couple of years, and we have our materials and proposal ready to present to Dr. Evers on Friday morning. So we are going to be sharing that information, and we are hoping, fingers crossed, that he will put his rubber stamp on that so that Wisconsin will become a seal of biliteracy state, joining, I believe, 13 others. And then once we have that established at the state level, districts like ours will be able to apply to become a Wisconsin Seal of Biliteracy granting district. So again, hopefully more information about that to come. So I guess the maybe something to end with is that one of the things that we're really working on across the district and within the community is really helping people see bilingualism as an asset. English learners are not deficient. They're coming to us with very rich languages and very rich cultures. And so really helping people see that, yes, some of them might struggle with learning and, you know, with English, but they are learning English and they do already have that wonderful, rich language experience that they bring with them. And we want to make sure that's something that we all see as a value. So.
Questions?
First of all, I just want to say you have a great voice.
Oh.
And you would be great with your one-hour radio show.
Thank you. Maybe you should listen to me in Spanish first. Before
I wouldn't know what you're talking about.
Well, thank you.
And I do have a relevant question.
Yeah.
And I think it's really interesting to see the long-term performance of the students. Mm-hmm. And as you mentioned about the ELLs who have graduated, who have dropped out and mm-hmm. exited.
Mm-hmm.
How do you get access to data? Do you do surveys? And what's the response rate?
Most of the data we've been looking at to date has been data that we've been able to mine from our own systems. So from Infinite Campus, from EduClimber, things like that. So we've been looking at breaking down the English learner population by gender, by free and reduced lunch, by ability status. I actually have my sheet right here, because I thought someone might ask. So good question. We've been looking at absenteeism. So are there attendance issues? How many years are in the program? Grade point average? Language spoken? To see if there are some patterns with some of our different language groups, as well as achievement data. So kind of breaking it down that way. We do really want some more anecdotal data, and that's what we're hoping to get from parents and at some point as from students as well, because certainly student perception and parent perception data are important to the process as well.
Thank you. Can I just jump in?
Yeah.
At our last session, I mean, we did start to see trends emerge. We focused on the non-graduates, and so now that we kind of know long-term trends, we can start talking about what interventions can we put into place mm-hmm. early mm-hmm. before we lose them. And mm-hmm. can I share one of the trends?
Yeah, for sure.
When we looked at our non-graduates, Spanish-speaking males from poverty. Mm-hmm. When you put those three factors together, mm-hmm. that was by far our largest group,
number.
Who came late to the district.
Yes.
So that they came, you know, maybe as level one or level two speakers, older in life, eighth grade, ninth grade. Mm-hmm. So we really were able to start to zero in on who our non-graduates are.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Would you be able to use the radio program La Movida to help the parents learn English? Is that a way for you to reach out and help them become bilingual?
Yeah, that's a good question. We actually do have really, I think the purpose of the radio program will be to share information. We've already been brainstorming lists of things like when it's time to enroll for 4K, for example, how can parents access that? Or at parent-teacher conferences, what are some really good questions you can ask the teachers, and how do you participate in that process? We do actually have an adult English class that we run for our parents. It's actually running now, this semester at Sauk Trail. It's always at Sauk Trail, but families from any school in the district can attend. This semester, we have a pretty large group. I want to say about 15 to 20 parents who are accessing that class. We partner with the Literacy Network to offer that, and we provide childcare so that parents can attend and bring their children. And that's been going pretty well for us over the last several years. We typically offer it once a semester, 6 to 8 weeks at a time. I think we've settled on 8 weeks seems to be a good number for the parents. So that's been exciting, and parents have also given us positive feedback about that, and they do try to work with the parents on language that's relevant to their communication with school. So how do you call in and say my child is sick or has an appointment, or again, parent-teacher conferences, or how do I understand what the nurse might be telling me about, you know, my son or daughter has a stomach ache or that sort of thing. So, yes. Great question.
Well, it certainly sounds like the La Movida radio station would certainly be an avenue of to reach out to parents mm-hmm. who were having a difficult time reaching. Do understand it would be a stretch for your language skills, but it certainly sounds like it.
She's quite proficient. He's quite proficient.
Okay.
Yeah.
You could have Diane as a guest.
Oh, there we go.
Yeah.
That'd be great.
Certainly does sound like an opportunity. So, go ahead.
Is there a within the district of having a dual language immersion program in the district?
Yeah, there. We heard loud and clear from our parents at Bilingual Family Engagement Night in September that they would really like to see us helping their kids maintain their language. I've also gotten phone calls and emails from parents who are native English speakers contacting me wondering, is Middleton going to have a dual language program? My daughter is 2. Do you think by the time she's in kindergarten there will be a dual language program? So I've contacted them and said, we'll know more in February, if you can hang in there with me. But that's part of what we would be looking at with our data, with research, and also knowing there would need to be resources involved with that. But I do think there is definitely interest in the community, both our English-speaking community and our Spanish-speaking community as well.
It's a hard position to fill, though, correct? I mean, the number of people that are certified in that area are pretty...
It is hard to find bilingually certified teachers, mainly due to the proficiency level requirement, which is high, as it should be. It's actually higher than world language proficiency requirements because the teacher is expected to deliver content in that second language, which is much more challenging in terms of academic language and vocabulary and structures than it might be to teach a world language in the, with the different goals of that sort of program. Yeah, they are challenging to find, but we do have a Grow Your Own program, and we're excited to have a potential, I guess, recent graduate working toward that, as well as a current paraeducator who's also working on that. So.
Mm-hmm. They don't want to teach in a sheltered instruction program where they might be delivering some pieces in Spanish. So if that were a direction we went, it would draw a different pool of
And you'd only have to add one a year.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Further questions? Okay. Thank you. I do appreciate the time you took.
Thank you very much for having me.
Muchas gracias. Review 2016-2017 calendar. I see, Donna, we have two calendars in front of us, and major difference being that we have the 19th, the 20th, and the 21st as basically non-school days versus the draft one, draft two, is that correct?
Yeah, 10-day break at during winter break versus a 7-day break. Right. And what we've found in the past is there has been a preference for the full 2 weeks. And so we thought we'd do a survey, probably Survey Monkey, with parents, staff, and students. Usually it's high school students, not our seniors because they're not going to be here, but we would do our freshmen, sophomore, juniors. And the one thing that maybe is out there that I could get your feedback on is, this is probably now the third year that we've had kind of like a 2-week winter break, and then the last week in March has been our traditional spring break. Sometimes there's a little bit of debate about where Easter falls. It's not supposed to be our major criteria because it's a religious holiday, but sometimes that's been out there. Generally, we've been the last full week of March, so we could consider looking at a comparable calendar for not just 15 or for 16-17, but 17-18. So that's we could technically just roll forward 2 years with comparable calendars as well. Just a thought. We want to definitely do, obviously, the 16-17 and get that put to bed, but we could actually establish a 2-year. Yeah, and then we wouldn't have to mess around with it. Yeah. So, anyway, so.
And is the feedback really going to change from your
life? I would doubt it. I mean, I think most people have favored 2 weeks at that holiday sort of winter break. And there are very few people that have said we want less than a week at spring break. And what we found more overwhelmingly in the spring is that they just want it to be consistent. They don't want it moved around a lot. So the difference is in some years we might have sort of the Friday holiday, which is certainly a Christian holiday, but we've had it off in many cases because there have been so many absences on that day. Mm-hmm. So sometimes there's a 6-day break in the spring. Sometimes it's all contiguous, sometimes depending on when Easter falls. And that's probably the biggest factor to kind of work in there. I think we're pretty much, I would be very surprised if people said they didn't want 2 weeks at the winter break.
Okay.
So, but we'll do the survey. We can get that done in probably a week. We do a Survey Monkey, get it out, tell people to do it right away. They're making two choices. They just appreciate getting the calendar early enough, especially before the holidays, so that the next holiday circuit that they make for next year, they can plan on, you know, at least a year in advance. So we've already seen a few questions on that. Not a big deal, and people have been very receptive. One said, why can't we do it 5 years out? I'm not sure, 5 years? Really, I'm not ready for 5 years.
Who books a vacation 5 years out?
I couldn't figure it out. He had a junior in high school, but no, I'm just kidding.
Yeah, right.
But so we're okay.
So if Good Friday and Easter are not within the week, do people get Good Friday? Do we typically?
Well, we haven't really had that happen for the last few years, so that would be the factor to consider. If it's a separate week completely, are we going to do that day or not? That's probably the factor, and it would then be implied that this is really honoring a Christian holiday versus others. So I think that would be a factor to consider if we were to continue to honor that sort of that, quote, Good Friday. That has been a tradition in the past, but it's actually lined up the last, I think, 3 years with just that March week. We did one year where it was actually a span between March and April, and some people didn't like that because it wasn't consistent, but it actually allowed us to sort of have the that Friday kind of within that window. So that's probably more of a factor than anything else. I don't think the 2 weeks at the winter break is a big issue at this point. So give you that background. We'll bring it back on the 9th.
Any further questions? Okay, at this point in time, I'm looking for a motion to convene in closed session.
So moved.
Second.
All those, okay, I guess we do a roll call on this one, if I remember correctly.
That's right.
Kelly?
Yes.
Yeah.
Aye.
Linda?
Aye.
Yes.
Aye.
Yes.
Okay. Closed session. A few minutes of stretch and...